Okay, can somebody confirm you can hear me?
Yeah, I
Great.
can hear you.
Lab six. All right, are there any questions? Before we begin, do remember there are two labs that I got graded the first time that you can make corrections by this Saturday. Lab five, I'm in the middle of grading, and I'm going to extend the time of when that one can be turned in because I haven't gotten it graded yet. I'm not sure how many. I think less than half the students are graded. My computer's a little slow because it's still making the movie from the Zoom session of our last lecture session, so it's going to be a little slow. And I'm rather hot today. Should open my door and turn on the air conditioning. All right, you should see my screen in just a minute here. There we go. Hopefully that'll shut down. There it goes. Like I said, my computer's a little slow. So today is August 3rd, and in the lab, we're going to be doing lab six, disk diffusion and antibiotics. Any question about any of that? And our next quiz will be over lab five and six. Hopefully, I'll get lab six done this weekend. Boy, that's a little close. Lab five won't be a problem. I should be able to get that one done, but lab six will be a problem. All right. Any questions about what we're doing? If not, let's move to lab six. Disk diffusion, the evaluation, disinfectants and antiseptics and antibiotic effectiveness. Realize we're mostly going to be talking about antibiotic effectiveness, but these procedures may be used to evaluate other substances like such as disinfectants and antiseptics. There is some reading, not very much, a page on terminology and microbial control. A couple of pages on principles of effective disinfection and evaluating a disinfectant, and then the different types of disinfectants. Read about the chemical methods of microbial control, just a page there. It looks like you're looking mainly at table 7.8. And then antibacterial drugs, antibiotics, another page there. And then a test guide to chemotherapy. The diffusion methods, and that's page 567 to 569. So two pages there. We do have some video clips in today's lab and a virtual lab. The learning objectives for this lab is one, be able to identify the type of chemical agent and the active ingredient used in various disinfectants and or antiseptics. Two, evaluate the effectiveness of disinfectants and antiseptics using disk diffusion. Three, determine the mode of action of various antibiotics. Four, evaluate the effectiveness of various antibiotics using disk diffusion. And number four will be the main focus of this lab. Any question about any of that? Five, be able to list the variables that influence antibiotic disk diffusion susceptibility testing. And six, define the terms. What's sterilization? Disinfection? What's a disinfectant? What's an antiseptic? What's a bactericidal agent? What's a bacteriostatic agent? What's an antibiotic? What is a spread plate? And what is the zone of inhibition? Any questions about any of that? All right. When we're evaluating disinfectants and antiseptics, you need to know the terms. Sterilization eliminates all viable organisms, including any endospores that may be present. Disinfection refers to the destruction of vegetative cells, but not necessarily endospores. When you use a chemical agent, we call that a disinfectant if the agent is to engage in disinfection. So a disinfectant is an agent applied to an inanimate object, such as when you're cleaning the toilet, you're using a disinfectant. An antiseptic is a chemical agent applied to living tissue. If you were to use the same agent on the toilet, which would be a disinfectant, and on your skin, you treat your skin with bleach, we would call that bleach treatment an antiseptic. But usually, disinfectants are different from antiseptics because a disinfectant is a little more harsh and detrimental to the skin, whereas antiseptics are a little more gentle. For example, chlorine bleach is a disinfectant. And we do have an antiseptic of the same member family, but it's iodine. Is it the same family? I think it's the same family. Yes, it's the same family. And iodine is used as an antiseptic. We don't typically use that as a disinfectant. To evaluate the effectiveness of a chemical agent, the surface of a nutrient agar plate is inoculated with a particular bacterium. And then after a few minutes, you put the paper disc containing different chemical agents to be tested on top of the surface of the agar. The chemical agent then diffuses into the agar, establishing a concentration around the disc. You then incubate the plate and allow the bacteria to grow. And then you observe the growth pattern around the disc. If a zone of inhibition shows around the disc, meaning there's no bacterial growth around the disc, the chemical is at least a little bit effective for that particular bacteria. Conversely, if there's no zone of inhibition, then the chemical is assumed to be ineffective against that particular bacterium. This table is showing you the different chemical agents, the general action of the agent, and the preferred use, like ethanol or isopropanol. It's really a degerming agent. We can use it as an antiseptic. These are too weak to be used as a disinfectant. And usually when we use it, we degerm the area. We clean up the bacteria in an agent of our skin with alcohol swab. And it doesn't remove all the bacteria from the agent, but it degerms the region so that the injection can be done safely. Aldehydes is one group. Halogens is the group I talked about, containing chlorine, bleach, and iodine. Iodine is used as an antiseptic. Chlorine, bleach, usually as a disinfectant. We'll talk about heavy metals. Peroxygens is like hydrogen peroxide, is a unique antiseptic because this agent can actually kill endospores, and we'll talk about that a little later. Phenolics is a compound based on phenol, can be used as a disinfectant or an antiseptic. Surface active agents like quaternary ammonium compounds is used as a disinfectant. The zone of inhibition around a disc depends only partially upon the sensitivity of the organism to the disinfectant or the antiseptic, whatever is in the disc. Various other factors also affect the zone size, including the concentration of the chemical. You have higher concentration of the chemical in the disc, you'll have a larger zone of inhibition. It will depend on the molecular weight of the agent. The smaller the molecular weight of the agent, the greater it diffuses through the auger, and the greater the size of the zone of inhibition. It'll also depend on the density of the bacterium put on the plate. If you put too much bacteria on the plate, meaning the density of the bacteria is very heavy, you'll get a smaller zone of inhibition than if you use the right concentration of bacteria on the plate. And then if you have too little bacteria on the plate, you'll have a larger zone of inhibition. Those are just showing you some things that can affect the size of the zone of inhibition. And there are many variables that have to be standardized. In evaluating the effectiveness of an antibiotic, we consider an antibiotic to be bactericidal if it kills the bacteria. If, on the other hand, the agent only inhibits the growth of the bacteria, it is considered bacteriostatic. Now, when we use an agent, we usually do not know by looking or off the top of your head if the agent is bactericidal or if it is bacteriostatic. I do happen to know that penicillin G is bactericidal, but most of the other antibiotics I do not know. So when we use it, we won't know if it's bactericidal or bacteriostatic unless you were to look it up. When a bacteriostatic antibiotic is used, it relies on the immune system to assist in the elimination of an infection, because the bacteriostatic agent doesn't remove the cell, it only keeps the cell from growing. The Kirby-Bayer disc diffusion test is the most commonly used method for antibiotic testing. The results of such testing often help a physician in choosing which antibiotic to use when treating a sick patient. Bacteria isolated from the patient and then grown on a auger plate in filter discs impregnated with an antibiotic is then applied to the auger. And then the antibiotic establishes a zone, a gradient around the antibiotic. And then we allow the plate to incubate to allow the bacteria to grow. You then allow the plate to grow specifically for 18 hours and at 35 degrees. And then look at the zone of inhibition around each antibiotic. Let me blow this up. So we have a large zone of inhibition around this disc, a smaller zone of inhibition around that disc, even smaller around that one. And this one and that one have essentially no zone of inhibition. So it's fairly safe to say that this antibiotic and that antibiotic is not going to be effective against this bacteria that we plated on the plate here. But which antibiotic is most efficient? This one, that one, or that one at stopping the growth of the bacteria or killing the bacteria? Which one is most efficient? Anyone want to guess?
The one with the smaller inhibition.
Most efficient? You say this one's most efficient?
Yeah. Yep.
Why are you saying that one?
Because it has a smaller zone of inhibition.
Well, the zone of inhibition is the region where the antibiotic prevented the bacteria from growing. So I'm a little confused why the smaller would be more efficient.
Because it stopped it, it means it killed it.
Say again.
I don't know. From reading this, it just made sense that it stopped the bacteria right there. So it stopped it from growing.
It is stopping
the bacteria
from growing here, but it's a small zone of inhibition. So this probably would not be the most effective. This one is probably the most effective. However, it may not be the most effective because let's say this antibiotic is very small and this antibiotic is very large. Then this antibiotic will diffuse through the auger less than this antibiotic. And so this antibiotic could be more effective at preventing the growth of the bacteria than this one. It's just this one is much smaller an antibiotic, so we expect it to have a larger zone of inhibition just because the antibiotic diffuses faster. Do you see the point? The point is, when you're just looking, you can't really say which antibiotic is the most efficient because we don't know the sizes of the antibiotics. If this one is very large and that one very small, that could explain why this one has a larger zone of inhibition than that one.
You say size, do you mean
the size of the antibiotic, meaning the molecular weight of it.
Okay.
The larger it is, the less it's going to diffuse through the auger.
Okay.
Okay.
Makes sense now.
And so the smaller it is, the more it will diffuse through the auger. All right. That tells you that the inhibition zone size is dependent on several factors. It is dependent on the diffusion rate of the antibiotic. A smaller antibiotic will diffuse faster and further. It'll depend on the degree of sensitivity of the microorganism to the antibiotic. For example, if these two had the same size, molecular weight of the antibiotic, then it would be concluded that if that were the only difference, the same size, and there's no other differences other than the sensitivity of the bacteria to the antibiotic, then the bacteria is more sensitive to this one than to that one. So it is dependent upon the sensitivity of the microorganism to that antibiotic, but it's also dependent on the growth rate of the bacterium. Like if we were to split the plate down the middle here and put one antibiotic on the top part of the plate, and excuse me, one bacteria on the top part of the plate and another antibiotic on the lower part of the plate, you can't really compare the lower part to the top part because they're different bacteria. So the growth rate of the bacteria are going to differ, as well as the sensitivity of the bacteria to the antibiotic. So there's several variables that need to be standardized when performing a Kirby-Bayer disdiffusion antibiotic test. And this table lists the variables that are always standardized when performing the Kirby-Bayer test. The nutrient broth will be made from several bacterial colonies grown on non-selective media. And the colonies should not be more than 24 hours old. The nutrient broth should be grown to a turbidity of 0.5 McFarland units. That's just a measurement of the cells in a turbidity meter. And that's approximately 1 × 10⁵ organisms per mil. You then inoculate the plate at room temperature, and you only inoculate Mueller-Hinton auger plates. Believe it or not, different types of media will display different zones of inhibition. So we only use Mueller-Hinton auger plate. And the Mueller-Hinton auger plate should have a pH between 7.2 and 7.4. If the pH is off, then you have to adjust the pH. And how you do that is with the liquid auger, you do the pH, and then you add acid to bring it into this range. And if it's too acidic, then you add base to bring it into this range. You then pour the plate at a depth of 4 millimeters, because believe it or not, a different depth of the auger will affect how much the antibiotic will diffuse through the plate. The higher or the greater the depth of the auger, the less the antibiotic will diffuse, and the less dense or the less deep the auger, the more the antibiotic will diffuse. And don't ask me why that is the case. I just know it is the case. So we always use a depth of 4 millimeters. And then we always use a plate of 150 millimeters. We then plate the plate with the bacteria using a non-toxic swab. And you use a spread plate where you put the bacteria everywhere on the auger plate. And then you place the disc on the plate at least 24 millimeters apart from each other, placing no more than 12 discs on a plate. You then allow the antibiotic disc to sit 5 minutes, but no longer than 15 minutes after inoculating the auger, meaning after you add the bacteria, you let the bacteria sit for at least 5 minutes, but no longer than 15 minutes. And then after 5 to 15 minutes, you put the antibiotic disc on the plate. So you add the antibiotic disc 5 to 15 minutes after you inoculate the auger with the bacteria. You then incubate the plates in an incubator for 16 to 18 hours, always at 35 degrees, and you put the plate in the incubator no longer than 15 minutes after adding the antibiotic disc. And so those variables are always standardized 35 to degrees and between 16 to 18 hours, no longer. The reason is if you over-incubate the plate, you'll get a smaller zone of inhibition. And if you under-incubate the plate, you will get a larger zone of inhibition. I imagine the temperature affects the size of the zone of inhibition, but I'm not entirely sure how, because with up to 37 degrees, you can increase the speed the bacteria grow. But if you increase the temperature, you also increase the diffusion of the antibiotic through the auger. So I'm not sure how the temperature affects the zone of inhibition. And it might be multifaceted. It could be. After incubation, you then take a look at the inhibition zone sizes, and you have to measure them. You measure the diameter using millimeters. And then you look at that measurement and compare it to the table set up by the National Committee for Clinical Laboratory Studies that sets the standards for interpreting the zone size of whether the bacteria is considered to be sensitive, intermediate, or resistant to that particular antibiotic that was tested. And National Committee for Clinical Laboratory Studies is too difficult to say, so most people just abbreviate it NCCLS. The point is, you have to measure the diameter of the zone of inhibition for this antibiotic, which in this case is penicillin G. And that looks like it's 20 millimeters. And then you look at the table. And for Staphylococcus aureus, they have a table. And this is the NCCLS table. And it says for Staphylococcus aureus, for penicillin G, if the zone of inhibition is 20 millimeters or less, this is considered resistant to this antibiotic. to be sensitive, the zone of inhibition has to be equal to or greater than 29 millimeters. And between 29 and 20, it is intermediate. Any questions about any of that? So to determine whether a bacteria is sensitive to an antibiotic, you have to do the Kirby-Bayer test. You have to measure the diameter of the zone of inhibition, and then you have to look in the NCCLS table of standards. And if the diameter is less than or equal to the size for resistant, you say it is resistant, which in this case it is. And if it is greater than the size for sensitive or equal to the size for sensitive, then it is sensitive. Each antibiotic will have a zone of inhibition size. And each species of bacteria will have a different zone of inhibition size. So Staphylococcus aureus will have a different zone of inhibition size for being resistant for penicillin G than it would have for tetracycline. And then E. coli would have a totally different size as well, because it's a different bacteria for the same antibiotic. Any question about any of that? All right, go over the terms. You don't need to go over the references. While you're not going to be physically performing any of these activities, you will be responsible for knowing how to interpret the effectiveness of antibiotics using the Kirby-Bayer disc diffusion test. We have a little video for you to watch on preparing a spread plate, and then review the steps for using the aseptic technique we use for preparing a spread plate for a bacterial lawn of growth. Let me go through this a little bit, just because there's something I want to point out. So what you do is, can you guys see this? Trying to show, this is a plate. This is my tube of bacteria. This is my cotton swab. Obviously, everything's pretend, right? You get the cotton swab and you dip it into the bacteria. You then take the cotton swab and touch it. Or maybe you can see it over here. Touch it to the inside of your tube to get the worst of the liquid off the cotton swab so it's not dripping. And then you take the cotton swab and you put it on the agar plate. And then you inoculate everywhere on the plate. This is supposed to be a round plate. It's not very round. But hopefully you're seeing I'm doing this everywhere. You then rotate the swab a quarter of a turn and rotate the plate a quarter of a turn. And then you rotate, inoculate the plate once again, everywhere, inoculating everywhere. And then you rotate the swab a quarter of a turn, rotate the plate a quarter of a turn. And then you inoculate everywhere again. So you're doing this three times. The purpose is so that you'll get the bacteria growing everywhere on the plate. That we call a lawn of bacteria, where the bacteria are growing everywhere on the plate. And once you've done it three times, you should then take the cotton swab and go around the edge to make sure you inoculate the edge. Because as you inoculate the edge, occasionally you will not get the edge. The point is to get the bacteria to grow everywhere. I once had a student who she went whoop, 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 boo, whoop, 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 boo, whoop, 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 boo. And then there were big gaps all over the plate without bacteria. And then she showed it to me and she said, what is the zone size of my zone of inhibition? And I looked at it and you couldn't tell because there were no zones of inhibition. And I said, well, you were supposed to inoculate the plate everywhere. You didn't do it everywhere. You have to do it everywhere. This test doesn't work. Any questions about that? And then what you should do is you take the plate and you let it sit for 5 to 15 minutes before you put the antibiotic disc down. And then before 15 minutes, you put the plate in the incubator, and it should be put in the incubator upside down. And then the labeling should be on the bottom of the incubator. You put it in a 35 degree incubator, 35 degrees Celsius, and then grow it for, I think it's 15 to 17 hours. Let me look up here. 16 to 18 hours. Got that a little wrong. 16 to 18 hours. All right, in procedure two, that's evaluating antibiotic effectiveness. We have a following video clip and a virtual lab for you to do. First, prepare a culture for the Kirby Bayer disc diffusion test. We have a little video. And then interpreting video on the interpretation of the results for the Kirby Bayer disc diffusion. I think this one has the old link, which doesn't work. I've got to run it from probably the... Oh, it does work. Never mind. I redid that. So once you get the Kirby Bayer disc diffusion test started, you can go through the description, the steps, and the credits. And this shows you a plate of E. coli set up. November 25, 2007. You then need to measure each of the antibiotics. This is streptomycin. I know that one because it's S easily. Take your ruler and just set it over there. Put the zero over there. That looks pretty good. So that looks a little less than 20. Let me get it a little better. That looks like about 19, maybe 20. And for streptomycin, well, 20 is greater than 15. So we click that. And if it's green, it means it's correct. If you kick a wrong answer, it'll get a red X through it. Okay. So you just do that for the others. Actually, penicillin there is essentially zero. I'm guessing it's there. Yep, it's there. For some reason, it's not there. It's here. So do that for this test. When you're done with this one, you can come to the menu and do it again. There's three different plates. So this is Pseudomonas aeruginosa, and there is a zone of inhibition, another zone of inhibition. A lot of these are not working on Pseudomonas aeruginosa. Mike E, is that erythromycin? Would be there. And then do it a third time, you get a third plate here, and that's Staphylococcus aureus. It looks like that's the only one that has a zone of inhibition for vancomycin. And its zone of inhibition is about 16, 17. So that's sensitive. This is telling you, I forgot to mention here, this is the resistant column. This is the intermediate column. Actually, it's stated right there. And then this is the sensitive column. So this is when the bacteria is susceptible to that antibiotic. and all these others, the bacteria is resistant to. And I'm going to assume that this is like more than Staphylococcus aureus. This is close to an MRSA, multi-drug resistant stuff. Staphylococcus aureus. Although I don't see penicillin here. Oh, there it is. All right, any questions about any of this? Like I said, there's three plates. You do it again, it goes back to the first one. So this is your virtual lab. The virtual lab, if you have a slow internet connection, may take some time to download. For me, that happened very quickly. All right, then use the standards required for the Kirby-Bayer susceptibility test. An E. coli culture is prepared using a spread plate technique. Antibiotic discs are placed on the surface of the auger and grown at 35 degrees. Below are the results, along with the NCCLS zone standards used for interpretation. And let's go ahead and go to the worksheet now. So it's showing you, let me blow this up. The zone of inhibition for ampicillin right here. And how you read this is you don't read it from here to there, which would be the logical thing. And that would be close to 9 millimeters. But you actually read it from here, zero, to there, zero. So this is 15 millimeters. And the reason for that is this zero is not placed right here. It's placed there. And so you have to read it zero to zero. And so this would be 15 millimeters for ampicillin. I'll actually do the first one for you. The antibiotic is ampicillin. And it was 15 millimeters. And then we look at the table. 15 millimeters for ampicillin for E. coli is intermediate. So you put the zone of inhibition in millimeters here, and then the interpretation here. For this one, we're going to put I. And then you do this for cephalofoxifen, gentamicin, and tetracycline. Any question about any of that? Oops. And there's the cephalofoxifen, gentamicin, and tetracycline. And you always use this table over here. We're not showing you that one. All right, that's question two. For question three, it says list five variables that must be standardized when performing the antibiotic susceptibility test using the Kirby-Bayer disk diffusion method. And you can get that directly from the lab module. And then further questions for question four. The size of the zone of inhibition often varies for two different species of bacteria when challenged with the same antibiotic. What is a possible explanation for these differences? So write your answer here. Five, what would happen if we didn't use aseptic technique to put the antibiotic disc on the plate? And in your answer, you should say what would happen to the test. So we're using a Kirby-Bayer test, and we have the disc put on the plate. Well, I don't have that shown here. And we put the disc on using non-sterile forceps, for example. So state what would happen, what would happen to the interpretation of the test. And six, what would happen if we increased the concentration of the antibiotic in the disc, as well as what would happen if we decrease the concentration of the antibiotic in the disc? B, Be specific in your answer, and your answer must explain both increasing the concentration and decreasing the concentration. Otherwise, it's partly wrong. Unless it's fully wrong, I guess. 7, antibiotics can be bactericidal, they kill the microbe, or they can be bacteriostatic, they inhibit microbial growth, but do not kill. When observing a zone of inhibition around a disc, how would you determine whether the antibiotic causing that zone was bactericidal or bacteriostatic? For example, on this disc here, we have a zone of inhibition shown here. Is that antibiotic bactericidal or bacteriostatic? Anyone have a guess?
Anyway, my guess is bacteriostatic.
Why?
Because it wasn't fully resistant.
Okay. That's not how you can tell. I'll just word it that way. You can't tell by looking at it. So that's a hint in your answer. So this is a thinking question. You have to think this one through. Number 7. And I just happen to know off the top of my head how penicillin works. And penicillin is not bacteriostatic. It's actually bactericidal. It kills bacteria. I know that one off the top of my head because I know penicillin G and all members of the penicillin family work in the same way. But generally off the top of my head, I have no idea. Like this one, I don't know if it's bactericidal or bacteriostatic. I don't know about that one. I don't know about that one either. But this one I happen to know. And that's just because I know how penicillin G works. So you have to think of how you could tell if it's bactericidal or bacteriostatic. And it's a thinking question. Generally, students tend to get it on the second try, meaning most of the students, you guys will struggle on the first try. And I'm telling you, this is a real thinking question. 8, when performing antibiotic sensitivity testing, it's important that the test conditions are kept very standardized, meaning the same type of media, the same egg or death, the same age of the culture, grown at the same temperature. Why? 9, are there other substances besides antibiotics that we could evaluate using this method, meaning the Kirby-Bauer disc diffusion method? And you should list those. That's not stated there, but you should just not answer yes or no. You should say, name what we could test. And you only need one answer, but you do need an answer. And then 10, does the presence of a zone of inhibition necessarily mean that the bacterium being tested is susceptible to that antibiotic? Explain your answer. All right, any questions about this lab? Any questions about anything? If not, I'm going to stop recording here.